Welcome to Break Forth Fully Alive.
We are Elsa and Arlen Salty, your hosts and the directors and founders of Break Forth Ministries.
We can all use a little inspiration in our day, and that's why Break Forth Fully Alive is here for you.
After four decades of holding events throughout the world, we're pulling together some of the best messages and classes from these events.
But before we get into today's show, we want to invite you to head over to our website at breakforthministries.com, where you'll learn more about our tours to the lands of the Bible, our resources, inspiring videos, workshops, our events, and more.
Now, let's get started.
Dr. Scot McKnight is a widely recognized authority on the New Testament, early Christianity, and the historical Jesus. He's the author of over 20 books, including the award-winning book, The Jesus Creed, Loving God, Loving Others. Join Scot in this talk based on his book, Embracing Grace. Examine how the Bible presents a robust gospel to deal with robust problems and create a solution. This talk will also tie together Jesus' vision of the kingdom and Paul's gospel. Here is Scot McKnight.
I teach at a college in the city of Chicago named North Park University. I taught before that I've been there 15 years, and 12 years prior to that, I taught at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School in Deerfield, Illinois, a seminary that I usually now call a cemetery. People think that's good. And I want to share with you a little bit about what I teach, because this project that I'm talking about in this session comes out of a book called Embracing Grace, emerged from a class I was teaching. And I teach freshman students in our honors division Introduction to the Bible in one semester. We call it Introduction to Biblical Studies, and it's extremely difficult. It'd be easier to teach the Bible for 2 years meeting every day than to teach 14 weeks, because you have to decide what not to talk about when you do a second, you know, when you do it this way. So it's difficult. But 50% of my students are Christians, and 50% are not, according to the demographic statistics that they fill out. So, pretty interesting mix in teaching 18-year-old kids who don't believe in Christianity what the Bible's all about. It's they ask questions that they shouldn't ask. They ask questions that others would never ask. And I think you will forgive me if I tell you that one day I was teaching a class, and we were in the book of Exodus, and I asked the students to read Exodus 1 through 24. And immediately a question came up in class about Exodus 4, where Yahweh is chasing down Moses because he hasn't circumcised his little boy, Gershom. You know this story. Student at the back of the class says, "What the hell, Dr. McKnight? Isn't God fast enough to catch Moses?" And I said, "You know, you're not supposed to talk like that in a Bible class." But he was not a Christian. And that was the way he asked the question. One of the most potent questions I've ever had in all the years I've taught the Bible. So they ask all the peculiar questions. They see all the texts they're not supposed to see. They like Jephthah, this brutal judge who slays his daughter. They want to know what that's about. They're not just interested in the covenant with Abraham, and that's what I want to talk about. And they want to talk about Jephthah and Tamar and Judah and all these peculiar passages in the Bible. Well, as a result of teaching the Bible, I see between 10 and 20 students every year become Christians, mostly simply because they've read the Bible for the first time, and they decide, this is what I want to believe in. This makes sense to me. And so my classes have become a little bit of a laboratory in conversion as I pay attention to how college students respond to the story of the Bible. I'll never forget one time I was teaching in a classroom, and at the back of the room, on the first day, I give my students a quiz. It's an attempt to find out what they know about the Bible, which isn't very much. So I give them a test that will reveal how much they know about the Bible, basic facts. And the last day of class, I give them the same test, and they don't have enough time in class to fill it all out, which is a good thing. First day, a young woman sits at the back. She comes up after about 10 minutes and says, I think I should drop this class. And I said, why? And she said, I can't answer any of the questions. And stupidly, I said, not even the first one? Which was, who are the first two people mentioned in the Bible? She said, not even the first one. Well, I said, this class is designed for you. I want you to stay in the class. And after about half a semester, she was fully alert to the Bible. And at the end of the semester, she filled out a form, and she told me in very Wesleyan words that she had no idea she was using. She says, every time I read the Bible, I feel like my heart is oddly warmed up, and I'd like to ask you what that's all about. And she became a Christian. She's a nurse today in the city of Chicago and doing very well. She's one of the happiest graduates I've ever seen in my life. She didn't come to North Park because it was a Christian school. She came because they had a nursing program, and she happened to take a Bible class that changed her life. And so this is what I do for a living. Pretty good gig, wouldn't you say? And the school sends me out to do this sort of thing. They think this is great, because probably none of you have ever heard of North Park University, and now you have. And we have a whole department of evangelical Christians, and all of us see numbers of kids converted every year. And it's really a lot of fun. And we don't have any responsibility for them once they leave our class. It's great. You know, pastors can take care of them. We just teach them. But a few years ago, about 5 years ago, I decided in teaching the Bible, I wanted to take a new angle to try to grasp it all in a slightly different way in order to help the students read the Bible toward a view of what's going on in the New Testament. And I decided to answer this question. What would the gospel look like if I began in Genesis 1 and read the whole Bible? What would the gospel look like if I read the whole Bible? Now, the reason I ask that is because most people's gospel can be taken lock, stock, and barrel from Romans, the whole thing. They may have learned the Romans road, and that's the gospel. Fair enough, that's fine. But what would the gospel look like if you began in Genesis 1? And it led to this book of mine called Embracing Grace. Because I think that there are reconfigurations and shifts that will occur if you take the whole Bible into consideration, and themes will come up that don't otherwise come up. And in particular, I think we have a distorted understanding of the gospel today. And you might think this is really silly for me to bring up. I mean, after all, we all agree on what the gospel is. And I would say we don't all agree on what the gospel is. And I'm finding a growing undercurrent of Christians who are dissatisfied with the way many people preach the gospel. And that gospel goes something like this, four steps. Number one, God loves you. I like this, straight out of Mr. Rogers. Number two, you're a sinner. Number three, Jesus came to earth to die for your sins so you could go to heaven. Number four, you just have to accept Jesus into your heart. That's a pretty standard way of presenting the gospel and talking about the gospel. And I'm pretty confident that that's a pretty standard way because of the number of my students who tell me that's what the gospel is. They're getting it from somewhere, and they're not all from the same church. And what I often say to my students on the first day, no one in the Bible teaches that gospel that way. And I usually have their attention for the next 10 minutes. It's got to be good after that, or they're on their cell phones, even in class, text messaging. So I would like to talk with you today about the gospel and suggest to you that I think we can do better in articulating the gospel by being more biblical. which is a very Protestant kind of thing to do, is to try to anchor and describe the Bible on the basis of what the Bible does say, rather than the way we have learned the gospel through gospel preaching. And I want to begin by talking about four or five problems that I see in the way we talk about the gospel. Now, I want to back up. I don't think any one of those four statements I made is wrong. But the way they're framed together is not the way anyone in the New Testament ever preaches the gospel. You don't ever see Paul doing that sort of thing in the book of Acts. It's not really the way Paul preaches the gospel, even in the book of Romans, which is quite an extensive discussion of salvation in Christ, the gospel. So I want to push and try to expand our understanding of the gospel to biblical proportions. So that's what our task is. But I want to begin with four problems. The first problem that I encounter as a college professor with students trying to get them to talk and understand the gospel as presented in the Bible is that they are convinced that they can love Jesus and not the church. And my friend Dan Kimball wrote a book about this. They love Jesus, but not the church. He actually wrote two books about this, plus they did a DVD. But if you just get one of them, you get the whole thing. I'm saying that so you won't buy all three of Dan's things. You buy have money left to buy one of mine. And I don't care if you read my books as long as you buy them. But Dan says that he is encountering an increasing number of young Christians who love Jesus but don't like the church. And when I read the Bible, I don't see people like this who love Yahweh, the God of the Old Testament, but not Israel, who follow Jesus but do not connect with the followers of Jesus, who are Spirit-baptized believers in the book of Acts but aren't connected to a church. There is no such thing as churchless followers of Jesus. So I'm concerned about this. But I think I know where it came from, and that leads me to my second problem. And I'll state it by talking about George Barna, who wrote a book called Revolution, in which he said, in the United States right now, there are 20 million evangelical Christians for whom the local church plays absolutely no role in their spiritual formation. And he calls them white-hot revolutionaries. It is not because these people don't believe in Jesus that they're not connected to the church. In sense, Barna would say it's because they do believe in Jesus that they're not connected to the church. And this is a serious problem for the church in the next generation, not to say for understanding what the Bible says. And that leads me to my third problem, and that's individualism. We live in an environment that is so rampantly individualistic that it has completely reshaped how we understand the gospel itself. So now when we preach the gospel, we preach that you personally are a sinner and that God loves you personally and that Jesus came to earth for you personally. And I've even heard people say that if there was no other sinners in the world, Jesus would have come to earth to die for you. I think that's a wonderful idea that has absolutely nothing to do with what the Bible talks about, but it's marvelous. Makes me feel really good about myself. And I think that's what's exactly designed to do. And we preach that if you accept Jesus personally, you can go to heaven personally, where God will look after your needs personally, eternally. This sort of individualism is deconstructing the church. And it's a gospel of individualism that is now being preached and leading people to see the church as an option, one of the options they have in growth, but just one, in their personal relationship with God. I want to say that I totally believe in the personal gospel, but a personal gospel is not the full gospel that's taught in the Bible. Any gospel that does not lead people into the church is not the gospel of the Bible. Fourth, somewhere, and I do not know the answer to this, but I have some suspicions, someone taught us that the gospel is simple and can be laid out in three or four statements. And we all believe this now. And I do not believe simplicity when it comes to articulating the gospel is a virtue. I believe the gospel can be stated in clear statements and it is reducible to language. But I don't see Jesus ever reducing the gospel to the same set of words, or Paul doing that either. When these people preached, the Spirit of God prompted them to say what was necessary for the moment to those people. And you can look at the Gospels. Whenever Jesus preaches, he doesn't have a set of lines that everybody has to subscribe to. And Paul does not do this. And I'm nervous about canning the gospel because it produces canned Christians. And it, if you reduce it, you reduce what people respond to, and you reduce the capacity of those people to live out the Christian life. And the fifth problem that I see is that the current gospel focus is too much on getting to heaven and not enough about living on earth. Now, if you have to choose living on earth versus living in heaven, and living in heaven is billions of years long, and living on earth is 85, I count on all of you living 85 years, well, then you're going to choose, you should, if you've got any brain in your head, you're going to choose the one that you last the longest. But it is not the case that the New Testament teaches a gospel that releases us from life on this earth in order to go to heaven, but it unleashes us for life on earth that will merge with the future. Tom Wright wrote a book last year, one of the most popular Christian books in all the Christian market, called Surprise by Hope, in which he argued that Christians have got this wrong. Eternal life is not in heaven, but in the new heavens and the new earth, which is what happens at the book of Revelation when the new Jerusalem comes to dwell upon the new earth. And that this life on earth will be transformed and the valleys will be made, you know, it'll be cool, all the rivers will be clean and all that. And the green people will be totally green. And all of us will be totally green, I suppose. But the idea is that we will not be released from life on this earth so that we can devalue it now, but that we will have this earth enhanced to its fullest proportions of what God has designed for it, with humans dwelling in that world. And I don't think Tom Wright's conclusions are as different as he likes to make them on this, but I think they're different enough from what the ordinary Christian perceives that this is a very important thing to take in consideration. Jesus said, "May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." This is the prayer that on earth God's kingdom will become manifest, rather than praying, "May we be released from life on this earth to dwell as evaporated spirits, singing in perfect unity in the heavens and the glorious beyond." That's not what the New Testament teaches. So I think these problems are arising right now in the church about articulating the gospel, and I would like to say that I think the gospel that we are preaching is actually producing these problems. And that the gospel, the problems we have right now with the 20-somethings not going to church, and the problems we have with the number of people who prefer Jesus over the church, has been in part, if not mostly, created by the sort of gospel that we're preaching that is so individualistic and so in the by and by in the heaven beyond that we are going to live with a serious problem if we don't correct it soon by preaching a more complete Bible and by preaching a more robust gospel. Well, that's my little plea for you. Those are my negative comments, and now I want to launch into talking about what I think the gospel of the Bible looks like when you start in Genesis chapter 1. And I want you, if you have questions, to jot down your questions, and at the end we'll try to have time. And if you're mad at me, it's okay. I'm a college teacher. I'm used to this. And if you have to sleep, I'm used to that too. But just don't let your cell phones ring. In my class, I answer any cell phone that rings. And I've talked to moms and dads from all over the world. No, your daughter's in class right now, and I would prefer that you not call her because I'm her teacher, and she's very embarrassed right now, and I hope you are too. And then we hang up, and they go away, and it never happens again. All right, I'd like to define the gospel, and I'd like you to write this down if you have notes. If you don't have notes, that's okay. This will help you understand how I think what the gospel looks like if we begin in Genesis chapter 1. The gospel is the work of the triune God. And we'll look at this in a minute. It is the work of the triune God to form a community. In the Bible, this community is expressed in three words: Israel, kingdom, and church. It is the work of the triune God to form a community in which, I'm going to use an expression that I'll explain in a few minutes, in which cracked icons, E-I-K-O-N-S, and this is my word for, it's a Greek transliteration of image of God. In which cracked icons are restored through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the Pentecostal gift of the Spirit. And the Pentecostal gift of the Spirit to union with God, communion with others, for the good of others and the world. To union with God, communion with others, for the good of others and the world. My big contention is that we are embraced by God's embracing grace to unleash a cycle of embracing grace in this world. We are embraced by God's embracing grace to unleash a cycle of embracing grace in this world. All right, did we get the definition? The gospel is the work of the triune God to form a community in which cracked icons are restored through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and the gift of the Pentecostal Spirit to union with God, communion with others, for the good of others and the world. All right. Now I'd like to suggest that we have to have three very important ideas on the table before we can ever understand the gospel as it is presented from Genesis 1 on. The first idea that I think we have to get on the table is one that you probably all agree with, and that is that God is a Trinity. Here's what I have learned in approximately 35 years of teaching and preaching and listening to theological discussions. Everybody believes in the Trinity because they're supposed to, And nobody knows what significance it has for life. We just know you better believe that, or you're a heretic. Right? We will fight endlessly for the deity of Christ, but we're not really fighting for the Trinity. Nor does Trinity hardly ever come up. And I told Chuck Colson this. I said, in your book on orthodoxy, you defend Trinity in one chapter vigorously. Good for you. It doesn't come up anywhere else in the book. So it must not matter. And this is a problem. Because if it doesn't matter, people will say they believe it. And we all say that in Sunday school classes and when we sign doctrinal statements. But what difference does it make? So I'd like to give you a Greek word that has been used in the history of the church for the Trinity that I think can transform our lives and our understanding of the gospel. And that Greek word is perichoresis. And here's how you spell it. P-E-R-I, peri, that means around. Choresis, C-H-O-R-E-S-I-S. Perichoresis. I don't know, is that my microphone making funny noises? The batteries are dying? You call for help? Are we still on? Okay. I think that was one of those hackers trying to get into the system and steal our information while we're talking. Our understanding of the Trinity was formulated in what is called in the 3rd and 4th century by some great theologians who are called the Cappadocian Fathers. And in that process, they formulated the idea of the perichoresis. It derives from a text like this, John 10:38, I and the Father are one. I dwell in the Father, and the Father dwells in me. And we ask, what does this mean? The perichoresis speaks of two categories. Well, I'll just use these words. It is the mutual indwelling and mutual interpenetration of the persons of the Trinity. So self-giving are they to one another that it becomes a little tussle of self-sacrifice among the persons of the Trinity to form what theologians have called the dance of the perichoresis. The dance of the Trinity. It wasn't C.S. Lewis who invented the dance of the Trinity in Mere Christianity. But it is the idea that the Father and the Son and the Spirit endlessly have loved one another in self-giving love eternally and for so long that we call it the perichoretic interpenetration and indwelling of one another. And as Dante uses at the end of Divine Comedy, three circles of light, and he can no longer tell which color is which circle because they indwell one another. It's a brilliant image of the perichoresis. And here's what I want you to understand about Christian theology of the gospel. The foundation of the gospel is the interpenetration of the persons of the Trinity who invite human beings into the dance. And only in that dance does the icon, the image of God, discover itself for who it is supposed to be. This endless love of Father, Son, and Spirit, which is so intimate that they can no longer tell themselves apart in the Trinitarian dance, exploded, as Jonathan Edwards said, into creation and into a creation spirit in order to create others who might enjoy the dance of the Trinity. And so we are invited in the gospel onto the dance floor where Father, Son, and Spirit are creating the dance itself. And true response of faith is the joy of the love of dancing with God in the Trinity. All right? This is what we believe. This is what the Trinity is about. It's not that the three are one and we can't understand it, and we will search for analogies. Maybe it's like a finger with three parts to the finger, but yet one finger. That's clever. Or like water, frozen, which is characteristic of Canada. It was a much warmer here than it was in Chicago when we got up here. So I thought, oh, this isn't so bad. I've heard. I once was at Briarcrest College, and the warmest it got was 28 below zero Fahrenheit. I thought that was pretty cool. I've never seen that. But it's like ice, water, and vapor. I mean, okay, that's fine. But we're trying to find analogies, and it's more important to understand the very substance of what this is, and it is the substance of mutual indwelling that is only approximated in beautiful marriages in this earth. It's only approximated there, but it's given an image of what God has created us to be. So the Trinity is the beginning of understanding the gospel. It's the work of the triune God to form a community for cracked icons. And now I want to, secondly, look at this idea of icons. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27 tell us that God created Ha-Adam in Hebrew, the Adam. It doesn't yet make him a male. He's the Adam. And gloriously, because the Adam, when he starts naming all the animals, start tears. I'm making this up, but it's right. Tears start coming down his face because even though he likes all these animals, especially a dog called a Bichon Frise, which is the height of creation just below humans. Ours just died this year, but it was a great dog for 17 years. So he went through all these animals, and at the end you can see him saying, but God, there's nothing like me. I need, in Hebrew it's called, I need a Habibi, someone to love. So God takes the Adam and splits the Adam. That's humor. Come on. It's as good as it gets for me. He splits the Adam into Ish and Isha, sort of like male and email. Or, yeah. All right. So he creates two because the Adam alone has no one to love. And then it is not like God, because God eternally exists in the perichoretic dance of love. And he wants Adam, now as a male, the Ish, to have an Isha he can love, and the Isha to have an Ish she can love, so that they can now become one as God is one. Now it's one becomes two becomes one. And the one is the Hebrew word echad, the same word Jesus would have used when he said, I and the Father are one. So that the oneness of the Trinity is expressed in part in the oneness of marriage, which becomes the prototype of all human relational workings. The desire for oneness, because that's what we're doing, is mimicking and watching the perichoretic dance and trying to manifest it as God's icons on earth. That's what it's about. And then, in Genesis chapter 3, the little Ish and the little Isha do something really stupid. They sin. And the first thing that happens when Ish and Isha sin, Adam and Eve, is they become shamed before God. So in their inner self, they are now cracked icons. The connection with God is broken. It's cracked. And the second thing they do is hide from God. So they're now cracked in themselves, and they're now cracked in their relationship with God, and then they become cracked in their relationship with one another. Eve blames Adam. Adam blames someone else. They cannot own responsibility with one another. And then because of their sin, God shows that their relationship, even with Eden, is cracked. And so he kicks them out of the garden, which I know was a golf course. A beautiful golf course. Not in the winter, but in the summer. A plush golf course with bent grass on the cool evening grass. Beautiful place to be. If you don't like golf, heaven will be boring. Or the new heavens and new earth will be boring. Because when God restores creation, he will restore to be golf courses everywhere. It's a glorious thing that we have to look forward to. So we are cracked in our relationship with God, self, others, and the world. Sign of the cross. God, self, others, and the world. All right, in my church, to make the sign of the cross was dangerous. But if you do it theologically like this and you're talking about salvation, you'll be all right. You get through it without getting in trouble. The rest of the Bible is about restoring cracked icons in their relationship with God, self, others, and the world. And a reduced gospel that we're preaching today, instead of a robust gospel, preaches a gospel where we can be restored to God. It does not preach a restoration so much to self or to others or to the world. It's solely this way. And there is some kind of assumption, which is always silly to make with human beings. There's an assumption that if we get restored with God, that will inevitably lead to restoration with self, others, and the world. I mean, looking around, it's pretty clear this is not happening. And so God lets Adam and Eve, Ish and Isha, horse around and screw up the world. And that's why we have Genesis 4 through 11, which I often tell my students was the first playwright for the movie Dumb and Dumber. Just read Genesis 4 through 11. It's goofy stuff. God says, we're going to start all over. These people are so bad. Wipe the place clean, flood the place, and we'll start all over. And then Noah starts acting up, and you think, man, what's going to happen? And God says, I'm going to start all over again. And he forms a covenant. And what is the goal of the covenant but to form a people called Israel? So the gospel is, if you read the Bible, you cannot skip legitimately, even though we do, from Genesis 3 to Romans 3. You can't do that. Or to John 3, we'll get a new birth. If you're more theological, Lutheran, you want to go to Romans 3. All right? You can't do this in the Bible. And my students would like to do this. And it is boring to read from Genesis 12 until you get to the New Testament. It's just one page after another about Israel. Why didn't God send Jesus in Genesis 4? This is what I learned in teaching the Bible. That I was wrong in wanting that to happen. Evidently, God really cares how communities live in this world. And that what God is doing in this world is restoring crack icons in the context of community. And anyone who reads the Bible cannot say they follow Jesus, but they're not connected to the church. There is no such thing as an Israelite not connected to Israel, or a kingdom member not connected to the kingdom, or a follower of Jesus not connected to followers of Jesus, or believers in Christ who are not connected to the church. So we've done something seriously wrong in so individualizing the gospel to create Christians who don't need the church. Cracked icons. One more thing about icons. This is one of the most significant words used of Jesus in the New Testament. Icon, again, means image of God. There were two Hebrew words, tselem and demut, but we translate them as image and likeness, and then the Greek is icon, and so I use the word icon to give us a new word to think with. And I think it helps us think about human beings as icons rather than human beings. It's nice to be humanitarian, but I'd rather be iconic in my understanding of humans as displaying the glory of God and representing God on earth. In Colossians chapter 1, Paul says that Jesus is the image of God, icon to theou. But even more importantly, in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18 through chapter 4, verse 4, Paul tells us that the Spirit of God has been downloaded into us so that we might be reformed and transformed and remade into the icon, the image of God in Christ, the glorious Christ. And that this is happening in a glorious manner, we are being transformed. So it teaches us by understanding that Jesus Christ is the true icon of God. When God created the Adam, Ha-Adam, in Genesis 1, he had consulted Christ, and he made the Adam to be like Christ, and he has allowed the Adams to live on earth in order to work this icon formation out in this world together. And that's what God is doing, and that's what the gospel is all about. So we begin with God as a Trinity and perichoresis of an explosion of making icons in order to enjoy the oneness that God is, so that we might be drawn into the dance and onto the dance floor of this world as icons. But we also have to begin at the end. All the endings of the Bible are really the beginnings. And the visions of eternity, the new heavens and the new earth of human beings, are human beings characterized by two words: worship and fellowship. Love of God and love of others. We worship God because we love him so deeply that this is the only way we can express our true relationship to him. We adore who he is. And we enjoy one another in koinonia, in fellowship, and in working together, and in striving together for God's will in the new heavens and new earth. We work our things out. And when we see that humans are made to worship and love God and to love others, we realize that icon formation in Christians today is about drawing people into loving God and loving others, because that is the dance of the perichoresis. Trinity really matters to me. And the West is obsessed with the Latin word esse, the being of God, and that all Father, Son, and Spirit all have the same being. And the East is dancing with the Trinity, with the perichoresis. And we're all growing. We're all asking today in theology for the East to teach us, because they got it right. We have almost become tritheists in the West, while the Eastern Christians in Orthodoxy have become genuine Trinitarian, and they are absorbed with the doctrine of the Trinity. All right? Three beginnings. Now I'd like to draw our attention to one more topic. What time? We finish at 2:30. Okay. I don't ever ask people what time it is, because my students lie to me when I ask them what time we finish. Finish at 11:15, Dr. McKnight. I thought we finished at 11:40. Oh, no, no, that changed. Okay. When we present the gospel, I am convinced that we are Good Friday only gospelers. Good Friday. We preach the cross. Good. But the gospel is a narration of the life, death, resurrection of Jesus. I have never seen a tract explain the gospel and talk anything about the life of Jesus or the resurrection of Jesus or the gift of the Spirit. And when you reduce the gospel to Good Friday, yes, Paul preached Christ crucified, but the cross was empty, so it implied the resurrection and the Messiah who had lived on earth to fulfill scriptures. I have never seen a tract ever mention the resurrection. And when you reduce the gospel to the cross, you reduce it to sin management. Erwin McManus said this last night. He swiped it from Dallas Willard. All right, the gospel of sin management. Anytime we preach only the cross, we are preaching forgiveness of sins and the elimination of guilt with God. But if you do not preach the resurrection, you don't preach that dead man can now walk and live. And if you don't preach the life of Jesus, you don't preach what the early Christians said, he became like us so that we might become like him, called the incarnation or union with Christ. And if you don't preach the Spirit in the gospel, you don't preach the empowerment of the Spirit that allows us to transform our inabilities and to transcend our abilities. That's what the Spirit does. Paul preaches in Romans 4:25 that we have been forgiven by his death and given justification through the resurrection. So a true Protestant gospel is that justification comes as a result of the resurrection. And I believe that we have a reduced gospel, and therefore we have reduced capacities and powers that are unleashed in the church. And I'll tell you a story that I think helps this. When I was in college, seminary, studying, we used to visit a mall that had a tobacco shop that had wonderful busts on the wall, heads, little heads like this. And I won't tell you why I was in the tobacco shop, but it didn't have anything to do with the tobacco. All right, so they had these little heads. And there was a head in there that I really liked. It was a Frenchman with a beret. And eventually, we decided that we would pop the money and buy it, and I bought it. And I named this little fella Pierre. It was the only French name I knew for someone wearing a beret, male name. So I bought Pierre. And Pierre had a twinkle in his eye, mischief in his face, and a great smile. And I put Pierre in my office, and then when I got a job at Trinity, I put Pierre on the wall. And sometimes I would just have students, I'd just say to them, what do you think of Pierre? And they'd look at Pierre, and they always smiled. Everybody liked Pierre. And then I got a new job at North Park University, and I put Pierre on the wall at North Park, and I would have students, what do you think of Pierre? And they'd look at Pierre, and they'd smile. Even administrators smiled when they looked at Pierre. Well, one day the windows were open, the door was open, and the wind blew strong, and it slammed the door and shook the wall, and Pierre fell to the ground into a million pieces. And I couldn't put little Pierre back together again. And so I can remember distinct. I had a metal wastebasket, and I picked him up and threw him in the wastebasket, and I said aloud, I'll miss you, Pierre. I'll miss you because you've brought a lot of smiles in my life. Well, I made up the name Pierre, and then Google came around, and I thought I'd see, you know, after 10 years, I thought, I'll find Pierre on the internet. Somebody's got a Pierre to sell on eBay. So I typed in Pierre. And I got a lot of Pierres, famous Pierres. And then I thought, Pierre Bust. And it was getting closer, but, you know, it was famous people with a bust. And I looked around, and I couldn't figure out even what they were called, so I forgot it. And then one day, I was talking to my son, Lucas, and I said, Lucas, I'm trying to find that old bust. You remember the bust of Pierre? Oh, yeah, Dad, the guy, little guy that made you smile. I said, I'm trying to find Pierre on the internet. Oh, he says, I'll find it. He's pretty good. One day, I get an email. Dad, here's Pierre. And so he found Pierre on the internet, these busts, and he said, you won't believe this, but it really is named Pierre. And so I bought another Pierre, and I put him on the wall, and I wanted to take it to school, and my wife wouldn't let me. She says, you've told this story too many times. He's in our house now. He's a member of the family, Pierre. Now, I tell you this because we're running out of time, and you're getting bored, and I want a story. I grew up Baptist. I know how to do these things. But in the Bible, we are cracked icons like Pierre. We're cracked Pierres. And you can toss cracked Pierres away. But that's not what the Bible does. It takes these pieces that are cracked and puts them together again. That's what forgiveness is all about. But it does even more than that. It makes them stand up and live. That's the resurrection. And it empowers them to glow with the presence of God in this world. And that's what we are. We are Pierres, cracked. But God wants the Pierres to glow in this world. And he will work with you to produce this. And this is exactly what he does. But he does this in the context of communities. And the gospel is about taking cracked icons and restoring them in the context of community through the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ and the gift of the Spirit, so that we might be in union with God, in communion with one another, and glow with the presence of God as we participate in God's perichoretic dance in this world. That's what the gospel's about. And so I think that God loves us. But more important than that, God is love. And that God's love is what characterizes. I had students one time say to me, what was God doing before creation? I said, did you ask me this because you think I'm that old? Well, she said, I do think you're pretty old. But she said, no. She said, I figured you'd know. And I said, God was perichoreting. Oh, she says, that's cool. What does that mean? And I think that's what God was endlessly doing. That's what God is doing now, and that's what God will do forever. And if we want to join the reality of God in this world, it's about the dance of the perichoresis. And the gospel is God's good news that we can dance on his floor with him. Yeah, you know, I think that God loves us and we're sinners and he died. That's fine. That's a part of the inner fabric, but this is a big picture, and it's a glorious picture, and we've got a bigger story to tell than those four simple points. We are embraced by God's embracing grace to unleash a cycle of embracing grace in this world, which means we are all evangelists for God's grace.
Thank you for joining us for this episode of the Break Forth Fully Alive podcast. We pray you were richly blessed.
But before we leave you, we want to remind you again to head over to our website at breakforthministries.com, where you'll learn more about our tours to the lands of the Bible, our resources, inspiring videos, workshops, our online and in-person events, and more.
Until next time, may you become fully alive in the love of God.